And I think just before I begin, I'll just tell you a little bit of the background of my own study and why I got to the point where I am now. I struggled like everybody else when I first started in Hong Kong. I started playing the saxophone when I was 12, around 12, and there was no saxophone teacher in Hong Kong at that point. And when I went to the band director, I said, well, I want to study an instrument. I wanted to study trumpet, because it's such a cool instrument, and you play high notes, and the trumpet players get to get all the girlfriends. So I wanted to be a trumpet player. But then when the band director looked at my hands, and and then he said, oh no, you would be very good with the saxophone. And then he gave me an old Selma saxophone. And I said, why? I want to play trumpet. And he said, no, saxophone is very good. And then later I found out that they needed a second alto for the band. So that's how I started. Not very inspiring, but that's how I began. When I first started saxophone, as I said, there was no teacher. So the only thing I had was a recording, two recordings. One was by Eugene Musso, the concerto. So at that time, we had the LP, the large record. You know what it is, right, still. and I made a cassette tape out of that, and I listened to it over and over and over. And then I tried to practice, trying to emulate the sound, trying to figure out how did it start the low register? How do I fix my tummy, to be lighter, for instance? So in the process, of course, I've tried a lot of things and I've done something wrong, but then eventually, fortunately, I didn't mess myself up too much. So by the time when I was at 18 or 19, I met Eugene Musso when he came to Hong Kong to give a master class. And after that, I went to the U.S. to study with him. And so that's a quick story. So what I'm trying to say is, I went through a lot of things as a young player without any directions. So in my mind, I have to keep thinking. So in my head, there are always three steps when you figure out problems. So the first step is, do you know what the first step is? The first step is realization, meaning you have to realize that there's a problem. Right? If you don't know there's a big problem, then you're not going to try to fix any problem. Right? So you have to know that there is a problem. And then the second step is analysis, which is you're trying to figure out what the problem is. Okay? In a very detailed way. For instance, the very common problem is your ring finger, right, which controls the octave key. So is your ring finger too slow? If it's too slow, is it because it's too close or is it because too far? How much, So the different position has different effects. Okay? And then once you figure out the problem, then the third stage is what I call the creative approach. When you think of different methods, many of you already know the patterns, dotted rhythm, or displacement pattern, that you change your practice habit to fix the issue. So that three steps that normally guide me through a lot of things. So today I actually want to talk about just focus on one area of a playing. I think all of us would agree that the most important thing when we play the saxophone is up here, right? So when there are four areas that I want to focus on today, let me first ask you a question. When you think about embouchure, what are you thinking? Lips? What else? Muscles around here, okay, what else? The air? about a shirt, you usually just think about the lip, right? Let me about the tongue. But let me say that when I say embouchure, I'm actually thinking about the entire unit. So think about your embouchure is controlling the shape of a bottle, which is inside your mouth. What I mean by that is this. Let's say the most common thing that people talk about is clarinet embouchure versus saxophone embouchure. So what is a clarinet embouchure? Yeah, it's much more, the chin is very flat, right? And the corners are pulled in, pretty tight, right? Pretty flat. Or as Dr. Lu so often say, it's a smirk. You know what a smirk is? You know, kind of like that, right? So, but what happens when you do that with your lips? Inside your oral cavity, can you feel? Does it feel like you have a lot of room? Not much, right? Okay. Now, how about, and I'll come back to this in a minute. How about like a saxophone embouchure that I think most of us would think of it as a more rounded embouchure, perhaps, right? Now, I know that some people may have different ideas, but just bear with me. I think in general, at least since I come from America, most of the Americans think of it as more like a round, old embouchure, right? And when you do that whole shape, go ahead, if you want to turn. What, how does it feel inside the mouth? It's round and has a lot more space, right? Right? But what is so amazing is this. I read in the 1960s, there's this acoustician in America called Bernard, Dr. Bernard. I read some of his articles and he sent me a lot of articles to read. One of the studies that he did was he was trying to prove that before the sound is generated in the mouthpiece or the instrument, the sound is actually generated inside your mouth. Okay? And this is vital because what I'm saying is, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that mouthpiece are not important or the saxophone is not very important. Of course, very important, you know that. But the tonal concept and control start here. Now, go back to the embouchure shape. Go back to the embouchure shape. Now, clarinet embouchure is not like that, right? So if I agitate the air inside your mouth with the clarinet embouchure, what would happen? That's all the sound there is. That's all the resonance. Right? But if I change it to a rounder embouchure, that is the resonance. So when the reed vibrates inside your mouth, the first thing happens is you have that air inside your pockets, the bar, and then it will shoot up to the mouthpiece and then an instrument and so on and so forth. So you see that the embouchure alone dictates how your sound is going to be like. Okay? Now again, I'm not saying that, you know, one thing is better than the other. What I'm saying is, acoustically, you cannot change that. So it's your choice. If you use a different embouchure, you won't be able to change the quality of the resonance itself. Okay? So that's vital. So embouchure, again, when you hopefully in the future, when you think about embouchure, it affects a lot more than just your lips and your face. Okay, next area. Next area that I think about a lot is the shape of the tongue position. Okay? And I won't spend too much time on this because I won't spend on another area. The tongue position, basically, if I want to just put it simply, is that there are basically three areas of the tongue, okay? One is the back, middle, or the tip of your tongue, okay? If there's one thing you remember for classical playing, which the back of the tongue has remained normal or hard. We almost never drop the throat. Because if you drop the back of the tongue, you're opening the throat area and you lose all the control there is. Right? I'm sure all of us have struggled with the low register control. It's because we open it and we lose it. Okay? So the first area, posture, tongue, and then the third area is related to the tongue, which is the back of your throat opening. So the back of the throat opening, think of it as like an aperture of a camera. Yeah? Any photography here? Yeah? You play around with the camera. So the aperture of the camera basically open and close according to the light, right? Or whatever light that you want to let in. So for the back of the throat opening, think about the, you know, maybe the low register, high register, altissimo range. The control of your airflow, it's controlled by that. And when, as I said earlier, the tongue position has to be high, the back of your tongue, right? So in general, most of the time, the back of the throat is relatively small. Okay? So the suggestion that I recommend people to start practicing is to talk like an hobbit. You know the movie Lord of the Rings? My precious. Kind of like a sound. So the back of your throat is closed. So that's actually a pretty good overall control position on that. So if you don't know how to do it, you can do it at home if you want to do it here. Alright, so the last area I want to talk about is, I haven't heard a lot about, and so I did a little bit of study, and I borrowed the idea from speech therapy. So I'm sure some of you have seen, you know, deaf people, they can't hear, and people trying to teach them how to talk. So what they do is they have to learn to articulate the air on the roof of their mouth, okay? And this works for any language, not just English, you know, it works with French, Italian, or Spanish, or Portuguese. We all actually are doing that every single day when we talk. Did you know that? You don't really think about it, right? But because if I don't articulate my air on the roof, it will sound like it. You won't know it will be right. Because my air is, my tongue is not moving, the air is not interacting with the roof, it doesn't pronounce the sound. Okay? So what does it have to do with that, with playing the saxophone? I found that it's actually very important because in the speech therapy, there are approximately 12 to 13 what they call the point of articulations on top of your roof. Okay? So for example, if I say the word key, you can think of the word in your own language. If you continue the airstream, can you tell where it's touching? You said it's a bad, right? Okay. I will come back to that. How about another word? Let's say like K-E, like K. Okay, is that the front or middle or the back? You said K was a bad, right? So what is K? The K is more bad. So which one is? Yes, the key is the front. I'll explain why you feel the back in a minute. So, how about last one? Last syllable is like a, let's say, car. K-A. The back, right? Yeah? So the reason why when I say key, you tell me that you're feeling the back is because when you say the word key, your tongue is raised. It has to be raised. Because you cannot say the word key when the tongue is down. Try it. question of why am I sound always so bright? It's not just the mouthpiece. Don't blame the mouthpiece or the beat or the next sensor. Check yourself first, always. And so what other things this nose to show is how my, when I move my tongue, okay, how it changes the sound.
Ear, believe.
from the T to just that part. That is your control center. And all the point of articulation also from there. So when you're doing overtones, you know that. Even when you even if you can do all this technique, I want you to go back and really think about and feel what your ear is interacting on the roof of your mouth. Okay? And remember, going back to the syllable, right? You can only say one syllable with one position. Okay? And it's similar to when you do altissimo. There's one position per note, right? There are, when I teach altissimo too, sometimes I say there are often just three results when you play altissimo, right? What are the three results? You guys know, right? So that three position, there is. Now, of course, there are, in between, there are a lot of different little positions, but generally, those are the three positions. So once you can master those, and one technique that I often ask students to do is just to practice those three positions, like intentionally, when they do it, because that gives you the range of motion. Well, it's very simple. You just don't go there. Or you don't go there. You go here. And then once you find that position, and then just use the ear. And just practice that spot. And muscle, the important thing to remember is, inside our mouth, imagination is all there is. Now, I'm sure some of you have seen videotapes of x-ray inside the mouth moving. Those are very cool. Wow, that's fun to watch, right? But when you turn off the video, you don't know what you're doing, right? You can't really see inside the mouth. So the important thing is you have to be able to imagine the position. Again, it's not an exact science, but if you know the direction in which you're going, I think it will be easier to control, I think. One more thing before maybe I open up for questions is that I recommend practicing air attack, which I find that not a lot of people do that. What I mean by that is you are practicing using this throat muscle. I'm sure some of you are already using it that maybe you don't even know you're using it. But there are three sets of muscle that we use when we play the wind instrument. One is your abdominal muscle, one is your intercostal, which is the chest muscle, and then your throat muscle. So how it works is when you breathe, you will pull out your tummy, as it were, and your diaphragm drop down, right? And then you have room. And then you can expand your lung. And then your throat muscle shoot it out, basically, right? So why is this important? Because it practices, first of all, the airspeed, the use of airspeed, and then your tongue position, how to guide your air. It's especially important on soprano play, I'm sure you know already. And so the air attack basically just practice air without tongue, like I just did with the altissimo range. Why is it an important technique? Because, for instance, you can articulate altissimo notes with very minimal effort. I'm sure you know the ending of the... how many of you play the Albright Sonata? Yeah? That's right. Yeah, the ending of the third movement, how does it go? Right? It's just like that. It's just like... I'm not using tongue at all. I'm just just using air. So, I mean, it really feels that easy than it looks. And that's really why I'm so passionate about it, because I want people to, they don't have to feel like they're trying to get that ending, right? And a lot of people struggle with that. So it's not really not enough. So practice, I recommend practicing just humming exercise with just the air.
Right?
My thing, of course. you will not be able to control, especially the lower register, the otami, right? So even some of the brass instruments, they use ku, which is okay for middle range. How about altissimo? It's just over, and then it will just go, right? So that gave me the idea that, remember, the tongue position, right? So I have to make sure my tongue, my pitch is very high, and my tongue is not moving. So I come up with tiki 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 syllable, so T-I-K-I, or whatever your language is. When you, by the way, when you use syllable, you have to be careful, because in Japan, for instance, 2-O, T-O is not 2. T-O is TO. So it's, oh, just use T-O all the time. Okay. That's the one of the funny things that you do when you travel around the world and you learn things from people. So it's very interesting. So tiki tiki or whatever your language, keep your tongue in a high position. Now the sound is very, sometimes it's confusing because the sound doesn't change as much when I'm thinking tuku tuku and tiki tiki. Little bit, but the pitch changes, right? Okay, so you have to be careful. And so my suggestion is make sure your tongue is high and use a different syllable to hit the different part of your root, the roof of the mouth. Very forward. Okay? Yeah. Any other question? Disagreement. No. Yes. So another thing I was going to think about the back of the tongue that I was I'm trying to remember what I've lost the train of thought here. With altissimo double tongue, how many of you do altissimo double tongue? No. Just recommendation is almost, to me anyway, for me, I don't know if other people do it easily, but for me it's very hard, and because any, even the highest syllable is going to not work. So that's another reason why if you can use the tongue, the throat muscle to, you want to talk about, right? Use that too. The second up. Basically key. So that I find that that's doable for the altissimo range. But strangely though, on the soprano, I don't know why, I can't explain it, but on soprano, it's actually easier on the high notes to do double tongue. I don't know why. Try it. And then you're going to like go really high, altissimo. Do it. You'll be able to do it. On soprano, but on alto, it's very much harder. Very much harder. So, yes. Yes. Yeah. B, B, okay. On a, like a baptism or a pumpkin? Like, yeah, this is very interesting. Because you shouldn't, because when you do, most of the time you will drop the pitch when you do the second syllable. It's actually very hard to go high. So, yes, then I would suggest you, again, play around. One of the things that I suggest people do, and I teach it all the time, is don't be afraid. Don't be afraid to use the mistakes to practice. A lot of people, when they play at this mode, what do they do? They go, you won't be able to learn what's happening. So just go for it and do it, you know. So you're finding your position. Of course, I mean, your neighbor is not going to like it, but I think it's very important for you to be able to find it. Different. But before you can find it though, you have to learn the different position. So you can experiment. Obviously I can, you know, I can share with you my experience and where to go. The most important thing is you individually find it. So don't feel like you're a stickler. Oh, you said I have to use